Hello students, let me continue with the chapter 5 review of C++. We have already seen the review of C++ language, the fundamentals of C++, the structures of C++ program in session 13. In this session, that is session 14, we are going to see about library function, the different fundamental data types, derived data types, user defined data types, input and output operations, the control statements, arrays, functions, user defined functions, and structures. Dear students, wanted to tell you, I've discussed very quickly in session 13 and 14 the whole syllabus what you people have gone through in the first POC. The outline only I have specified in these sessions. The library functions. C++ provides many built-in functions that save the programming time. The first one is their character functions. All the character functions require ctype.h header file. This is a library function. This includes is alpha, is digit, is upper, is lower. So it's a single character used to check, is it alphabet? For that we are using is alpha. Is it digit? To check, to decide. For that purpose we are using is digit. Whether that character is in upper case, to check we are using is upper. Whether that character is the lower case, we are using is lower. The next one is the string functions. The string functions are present in the string.h header file. To find the length of the string, to compare the string, to concat the string, to copy the string, to reverse the string, to convert into lowercase, to convert into uppercase, all these functions are belongs to this header file. Console input output functions. The console input output functions present in the stdio.h header file. For example, get char, put char, get string, put string. These all functions are belongs to this header file. The next one is their math input output function. The mathematical functions are present in this math.h header file. Seal, exponent, absolute, floor, log, power, sine, cos, tan, these all functions are belongs to this. C++ header. The C++ streams and IO routines are present in iostream.h, and input output manipulators are present in iomanipul.h. This is gives an idea for us, and this is makes user while developing any C++ program. We can make use of this existing functions in our program to make our program bit easier. Moving forward, the data types. Fundamental data types. The basic data types used in C++ are int, char, float, double and void. Int means integer, char means character type, float means fractional, double means the bigger number, and void means nothing. How to modify these existing basic data types by using modifiers that signed, unsigned, long and short. These four will be used to modify the basic data types. If you wanted to hold signed value, if you wanted to hold unsigned value, make use of these modifiers along with the fundamental data types. The next one is their derived data types. The arrays, the functions, pointer and references are derived data types. If you wanted to create any array, then you have to make use of the fundamental data type to create an array. Similarly, function also, pointer also, and references also. That is the reason we are calling these are derived data types. The last one is the user defined data types. According to the user requirements, he wanted to create in his own data type. So that is possible in C++ by using structure, by using union, by using class and enumerated. So we have already studied structure, and this year we are going to learn class. Let me deal with you the input and the output operations handled by C++. This is called input operator. Input in C++ is done by using stream extraction operator, as I have highlighted. On the scene stream, the operator must be followed by variable that will be store the data that is going to be extracted from the stream. So this is the way. So this will be there and variable name will be there. So whatever you are inputting from the keyboard, the C in is followed by input operator or extraction operator, which will be placed in the variable. The next one is their outputting. The outputting in C++ is done by using the object followed by stream insertion operator on the cout stream. So that is cout is having, this is your insert operator and the variable. Now whatever variable is holding the value, that will be displayed on the monitor. Just wanted to keep it in front of you, cascading of input and output operators. The C++ supports the use of stream extraction and stream insertion operation many times in a single input or output statements. Means at a time you can read more than one input from the keyboard to the different variable by using scene object and more than one input operator. Similarly, outputting also, at the same time you can display the value of two, three variables by using more than one output operator. So that is known as a cascading of input-output operators. Next is control statements. The control structure or a statements that can alter the flow of a sequence of instruction. Here we can do it in two, three ways. That's first one is the selection statements. Under selection statement, if statement is there, if else statement is there, nested statement is there, switch statement is there. This can be done by using or by creating the compound statement. Now what is compound statement? Compound statements are a block. Is a group of statements which are separated by semicolons. and grouped together in a block enclosed in a braces. The if statement will be decide only one direction, if else two, the branching what we are telling. So this is only one direction. If it is correct, then it get inside that block, otherwise it goes out. Here, if it is correct, then if block will be there, otherwise it goes to the else block. Nested if, it is if else statement is having one more if else statement within it. Now switch statement means multi-way branching. If it is A, then choose A block. If it is B means, then choose B block. If it is C means, choose C block. The next one is there, iteration statements. Iteration means repeating the process for the certain number of times. We have here while loop means pre-tested looping structure. We have one more loop is called do while loop, means post-tested looping structure. And the third one is there, for loop, fixed execution looping statement. There are three types of iteration statements will be. Whichever it is prefers user, that he can implement in his program. It is not necessary that they have to use while loop itself or a do while loop itself, a for loop. Which suits they can make use of. And here the transfer of control from within loop can be achieved by using these three statements: break, exit and continue. Break means terminating the execution of loop. Exit means you are exiting the from the program. Continue means halfway through the skip that loop. Means if it is that particular area it is not proper, means no, you go to the next iteration level. So this will be used, you know, transfer of a control from within the loop. Next one is their arrays, which I already discussed in chapter 4, but just putting in front of you, there are two types of arrays are there, one dimensional array and two dimensional array. The one dimensional array declare or defining by using one subscript. Two dimensional array will be used two subscript, and a multi-dimensional array using more than two subscript. So I will not discuss here detail because already we have seen it. The next one is their function. Function is a named group of statements developed to solve a subproblem and returns always a value to other function when it is called or where it is called. We have you know, big programs will be there or big task will be there, and in that task we cannot keep each and everything. For some places we need to particular small task will be there to execute. So that time we can put it those instruction in the function. When it is necessary, we can call it and it generates the result and gives the results where it is called and transfer the control to the main program. So that can be achieved by using a function concept. I'll just keep it in front of you. There are two types of functions are there. One is a library function and one more is user defined function. Library functions already I kept it in front of you and I have kept it examples also. So it's a collection of predefined function and other programming elements which are accessed through the header files. we include that header file in our program, and in that present many functions are there which is already defined by somebody else. So that's the reason we are telling it, we are calling it as a library function, and we are calling that function in our program by giving the value. It performs and generates the results and returns to the where we had called. Similarly, there's another type of function is there called user defined function. The user defined function is a complete and independent program which can be used by the main program or by other sub programs. So this is user created function. This is free defined, somebody else created, which we are accessing. Okay. I'll just give the structure of the function. There should be a return type specifier, and function name should be there, and argument list with the declaration should be there, and should be open with the brace. Body of the function will be there, that is local declaration, and then executable statements, and then return expression, and ends with the brace. The return type specifier is the data type of the value returned by the function to another function where it is called. Function name is the name of the function. The argument list with the declaration is the list of arguments or a parameters or a variables with their declaration. Body of the function contains local variable and the executable statements. How to call the function? Now you just imagine variable in your program and specify that function name and pass the argument list. This function now transfer will be transferred to that function where it belongs. There it performs and with the return value comes, and that value will be stored in the variable. So that means function can be called by specifying its name followed by list of arguments enclosed within the parentheses, or you can call the function without argument list also. You can directly, it is if there is nothing is there to send to the function, only performing is there, then you can directly call without the argument list, and that you can assign to the variable. So this is the else. Anyway, however it is possible, how it is useful to the user, in that way you can call it and you can store the types of arguments. A variable in a function header is called an argument. So what and all different types of arguments are there? One is actual arguments and one more is formal arguments. I just wanted to keep it in front of you. The function call statement contains name of the function and list of arguments to be passed. These arguments are a parameters called as actual arguments. That means this. Now this is a function call g equal to gcd of a comma b. Now here a and b are there. No, this is actual arguments. This is there in main program or somewhere else, but this is not a function. We are calling the function, and a b r belongs to in that program, in that particular area it is belongs. Now formal arguments in the function header in GCD index y is there, no? So that is what it means. The function header contains return type specifier, function name and list of arguments with their declaration. These arguments are called formal arguments or a dummy arguments. Now it is here. Now here this is function header, the return type specifier int is there, the function name GCD is there and the arguments with the declaration. So x and y in reality copies the value of a and b. It holds x holds a and y holds b, but they are dummy variables or formal arguments. The next one is the local variable. The variables declare inside function or a block is set belongs to that block. These variables are called as a local variables. It can be within the function, it can be within the main program, it can be within the submodules, subprograms. Those are called variables, local variables. They are belongs only that particular block. Outside that block we cannot use it. Their scope will be belongs to within that itself. Example, I am a principal of Gurukula PU College. So my scope is there limited to only Gurukula. I cannot be a principal of any other PU colleges. So I am local to only Gurukula. The next one is a global variable. The variable which are declared outside the functions are called global variable. Now outside the function if you are declared, that can be used in that any function in lies in that program. For example, in reality example to give you, DDPUE. The DDPUE is boss to Gurukula PU College as well as neighboring our colleges. He got a rights, how much is there at Gurukula? Same rights are there to the neighboring PU College. So he is global to our district. The director is global to the whole Karnataka. Yes. Moving forward, the user defined function. The types of user defined function. The function with no arguments and no return values. In this method, the function simply performs an independent task. It will not take any values, at the same time it will not return any value. The second one, function with the arguments and with the no return values. In this method, the function receives some argument and does not return any value. It will take only, it will not return. The third type, function with the no arguments and with the return values. In this method, the function receives no arguments but it returns the value. It expects something value to return, so we will return this value. The next function is function with the arguments with the return value. Now here function receives some arguments and it get executed and returns the value also. The last one is there, recursive function. Recursive function is a function that call itself. The process of calling a function by itself is called a recursion. The next concept is passing default arguments to function. passing default arguments to the function. Now when function is called, sometime we are passing the actual arguments and there are some values will be fixed. So that time what we are doing, we are passing the default values. So that type of is called passing default arguments. Passing constant arguments. Now that means the compiler cannot alter those values. So we are passing the constant values. It can be a integer constant, it can be a floating or character or a string constant. The next is there pass by value and call by value. The function where it is called, we are calling that function by value. And the function will receive the copy of that value. According to that it functions and returns that value. So here it alters in there locally. It will not alter any other places. It sends the copy to the where it is called. The next one is there pass by reference and call by reference. Now function will be passes the value where it is stored, no, the address will be passes. And at the same time, the function will be called the argument addresses. Now here both function as well as caller, both are accessing the same memory location. That is the reason here duplicate copy will not go, the actual copy will go. The next one is there, structures. And this is a user defined data type, which we have learned last year. How to defining the structure? The process of defining a structure is equivalent to defining your own data type. How you will declare the structure? You have to make use of struct keyword and then you have to specify the structure name, that is the identifier. And then open block by using brace and then specify member name by specifying the data type. You can have n number of members. You can have n number of members and then you have to close the block by specifying the closing brace followed by semicolon. This is the way we are creating the structure. To make it clear, I'll take a simple example. The structure definition to hold employee information. Now here employee's information it holds. So I used struct keyword and that name of this structure I used employee. Opened structure and the first member data is ID number of integer type. The second is character type of I used a variable, that is a name which holds 15 characters. The third one designation variable which holds 10 characters. And the fourth one is their salary holds fractional values. Closed bracket followed by semicolon. So this is employee is a data type which we can use it according to our requirement. And that can be defined by using employee as a keyword. Employee.e1, employee.e2, I can create a variables of this structure. Now e1.id number, I can make use of this member data. So member data can be identified by using dot operator or arrow operator. This is the end of chapter 5, that is review of C++. Thank you guys for listening me, and don't forget to subscribe my YouTube channel. God bless you.